if you're wondering, on top of going over the top, then you're not fishing. So probably about the sound system. You don't want to be back.
Can you hear me, Shirley? Good morning, Shirley. Shirley, can you hear me? Test. Welcome. How am I doing, Shirley? Hope in Christ Church, and welcome. And those of you out there in live stream, welcome to whenever you choose to watch this church service. Welcome. If I could invite you to pull out your bulletins, and we'll go through that. But I want to speak about the weather we've had this past week. What a beautiful week that we have been given. Kind of a little reprieve of what we could enjoy is a little bit of summer or early fall-like weather. Praise God for that. And I believe this morning was the coldest morning we've had so far to date in November. I had, 24 degrees? Someone said 21 degrees. So winter is coming. And I believe we're about halfway through deer hunting season. I heard lots of hunters in the woods through the gunshots. I've heard it right when it's daylight. They're out there. So praise God. New members class. So if you're interested in becoming a new member, please reach out to one of the elders or Pastor Steve. And speaking about new members, we'll be voting in a few weeks on the new members who attended back in September or late August. So we'll be voting in a few weeks for those. I'll be 5 or 6 people. The semi-annual meeting that we did not have yesterday, we had to postpone that, will be December 5th. Non-members and members are encouraged to attend. You're welcome to attend. We have a couple opportunities for our outreach ministries. The undercover food pantry is providing Thanksgiving dinners to the Chichester families. The office has the sign-up sheets, so please stay tuned and be thinking about how we can help out the families here in Chichester in a very tangible way. Now, another opportunity for outreach is not here in Chichester, but out in India. So last week, Paula gave us an update on what Yesupadam is doing in India. And there is a basket that she put in the back table out there, and that is for donations. Donations, I don't believe it's $30? Is it?
$10 to $15.
$10 to $15 can provide clothing for the pastor and his wife. So another opportunity to help out, clothe our missionaries in India. How can we pray for you? If you look in the seat pocket in front of you, there is a white card, a connect card. We would like to be able to pray for you as elders. We meet regularly and we pray for you, and it's also in your bulletin. So if it's confidential, you can plop it in the offering box in the back, and we'll be praying for you. Also, how we can connect with you. Awana, we're still in the process for trying to fully staff ourselves, but that we're gaining ground. Praise God for that. People are letting us know that they're interested. So I believe pretty soon we'll be kicking off, and more to come on that. And the invite cards, these little Hope in Christ cards, you can grab those and invite others. You would believe what it would take to get someone to come here to show interest. Friday night, I had an opportunity to spend an evening with some friends and to see Teen Challenge. They were here. They come here regularly every single year. But what an awesome opportunity to see how God is working in these men's lives. And we talked about, and we'll be singing about, chains and breaking chains and transformation in the Holy Spirit. But to hear these testimonies of these men, and how their lives are in the process, either starting out or have been transformed by God, breaking the chains of in their case addiction. But we all have chains. We all have chains that we're stuck. And relying on the power through obedience, I believe we're going to be going there today. In 1 John is obedience. Obedience. If you're a Christian, to obey. Now, if you're a kid and you choose to go to kids' church, we're going to play Follow the Leader. We're going to be talking about Elijah in Elijah, about following. But what an opportunity to see, an awesome opportunity for Teen Challenge and their awesome testimonies. But we all have a chain that we're trying to break and allow Jesus Christ to heal us. And in that transformation. Veterans Day was this past Wednesday. And we had an opportunity to observe that
as a state, as a nation. There are veterans here in this church body now. I'd like to take a moment, Evan, if you get that queued up, and we're going to watch a video for our veterans. So thank you to the men and women who have served in the armed forces, in this body, and out in live stream. Thank you for your service and your families. It costs something to serve. We have an opportunity as we transition from announcements over to worship. So would you bow your heads with me as we prepare our hearts? Father, I do thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us to pause our lives and to draw together as a family of believers. We celebrate you, Lord, for what you've given us, your Son Jesus Christ, freedom. And we're in that process of becoming more free. Thank you for giving us your eternal life. Thank you that you cared enough for us to have a relationship with us through your Son Jesus Christ. And thank you, Jesus, for being obedient. Thank you for wanting to do that. Lord, I pray that you would help us to unrestrain our hearts and our minds to give you the glory that you are due, because you are awesome and you are powerful and you are God. In Jesus' name I pray, and thank you. Amen. Let's worship, please.
Would you stand as we continue this morning? I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the dead. You did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord, my God, I called to you for help, and you healed me.
Sing the praises of the Lord, his faithful people. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping we stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning.
You turned my wailing into dancing. You remove my mourning and clothe me with joy, that my heart may sing your
thing for me to say good morning, right? Good morning.
Good morning.
If anybody that's going to participate in the Lord's Supper does not have one of these, raise your hand and somebody in the rear will bring one up to you. As was mentioned by Todd, we were called to a day of remembrance this week for veterans and the service and the sacrifice they made for our country. And we are thankful for the freedom that we enjoy because of that. We here at Hope in Christ are called to a celebration of remembrance, the Lord's Supper, roughly once a month, of what Jesus did for us with his sacrifice on the cross for the washing away of our sins before God, ushering in the new covenant. The new covenant is prophesied in Jeremiah in chapter 31, verses 31 to 33, if I may read. "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah." We are part of that. If you ever had a doubt, maybe because you aren't a Jew, a good exercise, a little homework would be, and you may have already done this, but look at the lineages and how they're listed in the New Testament, and look at it listed in the book of Matthew, and then look at it in the book of Luke. And then answer the question, what is the difference? Interesting. But in the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant which I made with the fathers, with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant, which they broke, although I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. But this is a new covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their hearts I will write it, his word. And I will be their God, and they will be my people. The words we often read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 26, are Paul's instructive words to the Corinthian church to correct a problem that was caused by the failure to understand the meaning of the Lord's Supper. He describes the issues in the previous verses, verse 17 through 22, then goes on to remind them of the solemn meaning of the Lord's Supper. In this time of remembrance, we bring to mind the freedom we can enjoy with hope, sense of purpose, joy, everlasting life that comes with the atonement of our sins. That is the gift to us made possible by the sacrifice that Jesus made for us on the cross. It is available to all. God desires all to come to know him in the knowledge of the truth. 1 Timothy 2:4. What Jesus did for us, you and me, on a very personal level, is ours for the asking. Not accepting this gift made possible by his death on the cross makes what he did for us, at least in my mind's eye, a painful memory. On the other hand, accepting and receiving the gift made possible by his sacrifice on the cross turns this painful event for Jesus into a blessing and a joyful victory for all involved. We here at Hope in Christ, we have some words, and I don't remember if it's our mission statement or something or other, and I should know this, but we are leading people to a complete and personal relationship with Jesus Christ. First and foremost, it has to be, I can't imagine a more important thing to do. I can't imagine something more important than telling somebody about Jesus, about somebody you know that doesn't know him, coming to know the Lord because of the little piece that you did, whether it was watering or whatever, planting a seed. And remember, that's all that Jesus sometimes asks you to do. But in that being so important, if there's somebody here that has not made that profession of faith, that has not asked Jesus into their heart, here or listening on one of their on their electrical device, whatever it may be, through this modern technology that we have today, I would invite you to pray this salvation prayer with me. And if you do know the Lord, I know you know somebody that doesn't, so I would ask that your prayer be that they hear it by some means of modern technology or whatever, because it is first and foremost what we are about. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your Son. But Lord Jesus, I ask you, please, to come into my heart, to come into my life. I feel the need, Lord God. The burdens of life are just too much to carry. I want what you have for me, Lord Jesus. I need for you to be in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. There is no special prayer. There is no set words. There's no decoder ring. There is a different way for almost everybody that comes to know the Lord. Most importantly, it's in the heart, the desire to know. If you said that, whether you're listening through the electronical devices or here, and you said that for the first time, tell somebody. Yeah, because your life has changed. So with all of that said and done, if you call the Lord Jesus your Lord and Savior, we welcome you to the Lord's table. And I don't know if there's any housekeeping, but you are, I'm going to remind you that you only need to take off the top layer to come to the element, as I will read in Corinthians. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, for which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Went on in verse 25. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Would you pray with me? Dear Lord God, thank you for loving us so much that you gave us your only begotten Son. Thank you, Jesus, for being obedient to the Father. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for the life that we have, which includes the hope and the joy, the purpose, an everlasting life with you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Thank you, Mark. And the kids and the teachers are released now for Kids Church. And this is the time of the service where we would normally take the collection. And as you know, we're not currently taking the collection individually because of the social distancing and all. We remind you that we have a box in the back of the church and also one over on the side. And if anyone is at home or would like to give online, hicnh.com is our website, and you can click on giving and you can follow the instructions. God is so good to us, and you hear us say it all the time. We'll continue to say it. We all know people that say, oh, I don't want to go to church because God just, they just want my money. And we know God doesn't want and doesn't need our money. What he really wants is our hearts. And sometimes we get asked, you know, how much should we give? And really, the answer, just like it is to everything for our lives, is right here. So I just wanted to read just two verses from 2 Corinthians where Paul says, it's a whole teaching on in chapter 8 and 9 on giving, but two very pertinent ones that are just great. First is chapter 8, verse 12. Paul says, "For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable, according to what one has and not according to what he does not have." There is no special amount. It's according to your heart. It's always to be the first fruits, Scripture teaches us. Not what's left over, but give the first and the best that you have to the Lord. And if we say the willingness is there, what does the willingness mean? And we skip over to chapter 9, verse 7. And Paul says that each one should give what he has decided in his heart to give. Not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Don't figure out exactly to the penny what you need to give. Look into your heart and give out of your heart, and that's what's acceptable and pleasing to God. That's what he really wants. And so so we just thank the Lord. I want to pray and thank him. Lord, you are so faithful to us, Lord. This year you have grown us in people, Lord, and in people who desire to work, and in people who have come to know Jesus as their Savior, Lord, who might not have known in this past year. Lord, you have been faithful that you have provided for us in difficult times, Lord, in abundance. As we prepare for the budget for next year, Lord, we see your faithfulness, and we will be able to share that together soon in our meetings. But we thank you, Father, for loving us, for knowing that you desire what's in our hearts, Lord, and that that we have the opportunity to give with joy. In Jesus' name, amen. So this is the time we'd like to hear from a few of you of what is God doing that's a blessing to you this morning. Okay, so Paula was sharing that she heard from a high school friend that she had not heard from for a long time, since high school, not too long, but that she was able to share Jesus. And so we want to pray for Brenda, is her name. And Paula, the blessing for me last week was just hearing, and this morning too, before, as we were practicing for the worship team, As Paula shared last week, we'd planned on 25 shoeboxes. They packed up 50. And then Paula shared this morning that not only did we have 25 more, but when she went to package them all up with the shipping, there was 54. So either God multiplied or someone provided some more. But What great opportunity. Don't forget to be praying for those boxes to go with more than what's in them, but to go with the Holy Spirit along to reach these children. So who else would like to share something this morning? Good. Mike sharing that he has a potentially serious and expensive, and unfortunately those go together when you say plumbing problem. So we need to, God loves us and cares about everything and all our needs, doesn't he? So it's good to pray for that. Someone else? Bob?
Friends of ours, their daughter, Casey, she's about 11 years old, she's going for spinal surgery this week. She went through a year of trying to get braces.
Okay, so we want to be praying for Casey. She's 11 and is having spinal surgery this week. Serious thing. Hold her before the Lord. Anyone else? Don. Okay, Don's sister-in-law is donating a kidney. We've been praying for that, and the surgery now is Tuesday. So make a note and be praying Tuesday for that surgery. Anyone else? So before we go to prayer, we'll just review our prayer list. There are many people on it. Casey, we had already mentioned, and we want to remember Brenda. The Henninger family, Stella and Tim and James and Evan, are home, and Tim had been diagnosed with COVID and his symptoms are mild, and we're praying that he will be fine and also that the rest of the family will stay healthy. So we're praying for you all, Stella and Tim, James and Evan. We know you're watching. Kevin and Katie H. that have been looking for discernment and encouragement. They've visited with us before and are feeling that the Lord is calling them to perhaps sell their house in, I believe it's Tennessee, and move up here and become part of this body. And isn't that a neat thing that God would be leading people in direction like that? We want to be continuing to pray for Florence, for Judy, for Wayne. Wayne is still undergoing treatment for many different cancers, I think four of them in his body. And Jack McGrath. And we want to be praying for our country and also for the spiritual needs in the community. So let's join our hearts together again and come before the throne. There's a lot of power if we join our hearts together before Jesus. Father, first of all, we thank you that you are the Almighty, that you are everywhere. Father, we thank you for your word that teaches us that you know even the hairs on our head. Lord, you know all the details. You have created each one of us. You are in control, Lord. You've created the universe. And we thank you, Lord, that we can trust you. We thank you, Father, for your guidance. We thank you for sending Jesus, Lord, that we might, through him, be forgiven our sins and cleansed and enter into the kingdom with you forever, Lord, for eternity. We come this morning, Father, with thanksgiving in our hearts for what you are doing in our midst. Father, we thank you for reminding us that your ways are not our ways, and for comforting us in our times of difficulty, Lord, and for also rejoicing with us in our times of joy. And Father, this morning we want to remember all the individuals that we've mentioned and have been praying about, Lord, and in particular for the little 11-year-old Cassie who's going to have surgery, Lord, on her spine, and also for Don's sister-in-law that's donating a kidney, Lord. We pray that you will be with these people with the surgeries, Lord, that they will go well, that you will be right there with them. We pray, Father, for the healing that's needed by many in our midst, in our body here, and that might be listening at home. Father, it's easy to just gloss over and generalize, but again, we know that you know every one of us, that we are your creation and you are the creator. And Lord, we ask that you might reach your healing hand upon each one that needs it, Lord, whether it's physical or spiritual or mental, Father, healing that needs to take place. You are the great healer, and we thank you, Father. And Lord, we pray for our country. It's still divided, and still things are not settled, Father, finally and completely. We pray, Father, that you will bring healing. We ask your forgiveness, Father, for allowing our country to come to the point that we're at. And we pray, Father, that we might think of one another more highly than ourselves. Whether we agree, Lord, with each other in principles on political things or whatever it might be, Lord, that we would still love one another first, just as you have loved us. We pray, Father, for our leaders, for your guidance. We pray especially, Lord, that you would remove the scales from their eyes where necessary and that they would see truth, not what we perceive as truth, but your truth, Lord, that they would see that truth and be willing to abide in it, Lord, and to lead us accordingly. Father, we pray for the churches in our local area that are preaching the gospel and the good news of Jesus Christ. We pray, Father, that we know there are many difficult scenarios with the different churches right now. With COVID, there are some that still have not been able to open up for various reasons. There are some people who still feel they need to stay away, Lord, to be safe. And so, Father, we pray that you will give wisdom to the leaders, and through your Holy Spirit, guide each church to be able to minister to those in their body and also in their community, Lord, and that we would be willing to help one another through this time, and that we would be joined together in the larger body of Christ, Lord, each one of our local churches having a special gift that you've given us, Lord, of ministry in certain areas. We pray for the pastors and their families, for protection for them, Lord, and for endurance and encouragement. Father, we thank you for what you're doing in our midst here at Hope in Christ Church. You are growing us, Lord. But we don't pray to just grow in numbers. That's not important. What we pray, Father, is that you will help us to all be workers and to be committed to do some part of work in the body that is for your purpose. And Lord, that you will use each one of us to reach people who don't know Jesus in this community and be prepared, Father, as you bring more and more people to us and as we reach out so that we can minister effectively, Lord, and to accomplish what you would have us to do here at Hope in Christ. We thank you again, Father. We trust you. We love you, and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today, but I suppose I could be making worse noises. Should I try that again? Huh? Better. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Try and find all my accessories here. Check. Check. Okay, yes, and I have my black Bible, so beware, right? This is the heavy one. If you have your Bibles, if you have some a pen in your outline, you can pull those out now. If you're missing any of those three things, there's a stack on the table in the foyer, and I promise you'll be back in your seat before we get into the meat of the sermon. A couple of things that I forgot to mention to Todd is we have a men's group here on Wednesday that's really pretty cool if you are a man, and nothing. I guess that's all you have to do is be a man. Wednesday night, we have a ball. We kick around scripture and how to apply it to our lives and God's call to us in this world. So it's a lot of fun and fudge-covered devil dogs have been known to show up there now and then. So, love to see you. We don't have a cool name for it yet, you know, just like men's ministry. So, we're working on that. This week, we're not in Jeremiah. Imagine that. I'm beginning a new sermon series starting this week in the book of 2 John. And if you turn me there with me there, we'll get underway. It's only 13 verses, the entire book, but it really works to refocus Christians on a basic element of our life. And that's the concept of truth. Right? You probably think, most of us probably think we have a pretty good handle on that concept, what it means and how we use it. But John really has some great insights here for all Christians on the subject of truth. And if we don't have a good grip on the concept of truth, how we get it, where it comes from, how to use it, how to discern it, we can really get off track very quickly. A good example of this was a kid that went out for the track team, not because he loved track, but because his father was a track star when he was a young man. The kid went along with it, trying to please his father. Unfortunately, this kid was not track star material. In his first meet, he had to line up in the 440 against the state champion. Everybody knew this state champion was going to be there, so nobody else wanted to race him, and this kid didn't know any better. So when they called the racers to the starting line, it was just the state champion and this kid that didn't know anything about running except put one foot in front of the other. And when the starter shot the pistol, the state champ was off. And the kid was kind of shuffling along. And at the finish line, the state champion did a great, great time, and the kid was barely halfway finished. And that night at dinner time, when the kid's father said to son, "Tell me about your first track meet." And the son thought for a second and said, "Well, I was lined up against the state champ in our race. He came in second to last, but I came in second place." Right? Technically, he was right. There was only two of them racing. So the truth was there. It just wasn't handled correctly, was it? So there has to be more involved in our concept of truth than just what is truth. You know, we need to know how to deal with it. Right? That's why I put Morgan Freeman up there. I love that quote. You know? He's right, you know. You gotta use your finger or else it doesn't work. Right? He's right, you know. Because no matter, usually when you see him saying that, he's clear in the air, right? Because no matter how emotionally charged a situation is, no matter how eloquent the speech or how convincing the argument or how powerful or important the speaker is, truth is truth, right? It stands as an exact representation of reality or what really is, right? There's a definition in your outline. I did the best I could with it. Right? We do what we do because of what the truth is. Truth is everlasting substance that can be relied upon as what corresponds to reality, or just what really is. Truth. God is the author of truth, right? Hebrews 6:18. Jesus is the truth, John 14:16. And the Holy Spirit that dwells in all believers is the Spirit of truth, right? That's John 14:17. So that's where the truth comes from. We looked at a second ago at what truth is. But how can we get a hold of it? And when we do get a hold of it, what should we do with it? Well, first things first, let's take a look at where it comes from. Matthew 16, verse 13. I'm confused. This Bible's not all marked up, so I'm a little confused with it. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" Talking about himself. And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And Jesus said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is heaven. Who is in heaven, I'm sorry. We receive truth from God as he reveals it to us. But then what? Well, the second letter of John is a great explanation of what Christians should do with the truth. And that's our big idea for this week. The one thing that I pray that you'll take home from this service is the fact that Christians follow Jesus by walking according to the truth of his teaching. Right? As a Christian, we're commanded to follow Christ. Right? To live a life that replicates his best we can. You know, by submitting to God's commands, submitting to his character and his plan for our life. We do this by walking, right? That's the Christianese term for doing what we do, for living, walking. We do that in accordance with what he taught, the truth of his teaching. Right? Let's get to the truth as expressed by 2 John, by drawing kind of, why don't we draw a line between where we were over the past couple months and today, right? Let's draw a line between Jeremiah and John writing this epistle, and see what it reveals about truth, right? As we've been in Jeremiah for a couple months, we were in it a couple months last winter, and we saw a lot of the things that Jeremiah was warning the people about, and just like he had warned the nation of Judah, their whole country was conquered, and the people were carried off into slavery for 70 years. But after that nation, Babylon, was itself conquered by Persia, the people were allowed to return to Jerusalem, established the city and the walls and the temple, and the Jewish people never again fell into the sin of worshiping the false gods and false idols that were brought in from the nations around them. That was the end of that. But they did, of course, continue to struggle, like we all do, with other idols, right? It might not be a totem pole with Gilligan's head on the top or a Buddha with whose stomach that you rub, but it's the god of pride, the idol of self-love. We saw Jeremiah warn the people about this, right? Created separation between people and God. But as God had promised, the Messiah was born, lived a perfect life, no sin whatsoever, began a ministry of preaching and healing and revelation from God that showed how his life, his death, his resurrection would be sufficient for the salvation of all who would repent and believe. Right? The separation that all people have from God that's brought on by our love for ourselves, our love for what the world offers us, can be healed by faith in Christ and what he did to save us. But the sin that separates us from him must be paid for, because God is a truly just God, and sin can't just be ignored by a God that's truly just. Right, so Jesus, the promised Messiah, was killed according to the foreknowledge and definite plan of God at the hands of lawless men. Okay, that's Acts 2:23. Right, this death of a perfect sinless man who was also fully God is the payment for our sin. Right, the wrath of God that must be applied to sin was poured out onto Jesus on that cross, and the righteous life of Jesus is applied to our lives when we trust in God, when we believe in Christ for the forgiveness of our sins and repent from our old life of self-centeredness. That's the truth. That's the truth that John's going to be talking about today. The truth of the gospel, the everlasting truth of God, is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Right? All the historical accounts in the Bible are true. All the ethical commands in the Bible, also true. But all of that, all of creation, it's all about the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the truth of God. God didn't create the universe. He didn't create all of us as some kind of random act or some kind of hobby to keep himself occupied, keep himself amused. He created us so that we can glorify him. And the only way that we can do that is with the truth of the gospel, because without the gospel, we're separated from him. Separated from him by our sin. During Jesus' 3 years of ministry here, he surrounded himself with 12 disciples, one of which was John. Joan had a rough start, but he aged well. You know, he wanted to rain thunder down on people that didn't believe, whole towns. He wanted to have the best place to sit. He kind of had his mother go over and ask Jesus some things that weren't too helpful, but as we can see in these epistles here in the book of Revelation that we studied over the summer, he really came around, right? His account of the gospel is an amazing theological framework and we can understand our faith. His three epistles to the churches are wonderful, encouraging, yet convicting messages for our churches. And the book of Revelation, penned by him, is an amazing personal tour of end times by Christ himself. And the word of truth is found, 38 times in these writings, and that's in the ESV. Some of the other versions, it's even more. And John really, really, really was stuck on truth and love as well, but love as truth. And John, like many church leaders, had left Jerusalem around 67 AD, prior to the Romans destroying the city. It was probable that John wrote this letter along with the two others, right, John 1 and John 3, sometimes maybe 75 or 80 AD, while serving as an elder in the church at Ephesus, writing to churches, probably the same ones that he wrote to for the book of Revelation, right, Philadelphia, Laodicea, Pergamum, cities like that. So now that we can see where this book sits, how it's connected with the book of Jeremiah, right, that we've been in for the last couple months, let's see what John has to say, right? John 2. There it is. The elder to the elect lady and her children, whom I love in truth, and only I, but also all who know the truth, because of the truth that abides in us, and will be with us forever. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. I rejoice greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. And now I ask you, dear lady, not as though I were writing you a new commandment, but the one we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, so that you should walk in it. For many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. Such a one is the deceiver and the antichrist. Watch yourselves so that you may not lose what we have worked for, but may win a full reward. Everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teachings of Christ does not have God. Whoever abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive them into your house or give him any greetings, for whoever greets him takes part in his wicked works. Though I have much to write to you, I would rather not use paper and ink. Instead, I hope to come to you and talk face to face so that our joy may be complete. The children of your elect sister greet you. Pretty straightforward, right? The truth of the gospel and what to do with it as a Christian. The Christians then and Christians now need a little shot in the arm once in a while. Keep encouraged and strengthened, because it seems like a constant battle to stay devoted to the truth, right? Everything around you, and the television, the stores that you shop, the people that you meet, everything in the culture seems to be removed from the truth. It's like an opposite day. We're trying to follow Jesus in submission to God's plan according to the truth that he has revealed, but we need help, right? We need to handle the truth correctly. And to do this, the first thing that God, through John, wants us to understand is that Christians follow Jesus by loving the truth. We see this in the first three verses. This letter sounds like it's addressed to a woman and her children, but it's really a veiled attempt to hide the identity of church and its leaders, right? These letters could fall into the hands of Roman Christian persecutors en route. So these type of introductions were very, very common in these days. Right? At this time, persecution of churches was normal practice in the Roman territories. Right? This letter was not penned many years before. John himself was apparently, okay, this is extra biblical sources, that he was captured, tortured, and banished to the island of Patmos, where he writes the letter of the book of Revelation. Okay? Very well could be because one of these letters, just like this, was intercepted, and he was called out on it. Right, subject to Rome throughout this whole area, expected to worship the emperor alone. Or die, you choose. You had a choice. Right, and these three verses show us that the truth of the gospel should unify Christians in love for each other, just as he loves them in truth. Right, they're joined together in the unity of their faith and salvation. It's the basis for Christian love. We're all loved by the same God. We're all loved by him in the same way for the same reason. And that creates a love between us. It's all based on the truth of the gospel, the truth that Christians share. Right? It isn't because we all live in the same town. It's not because we vote the same way or have similar interests or we happen to show up in the same building on Sunday. It's because we're all wretched sinners saved by grace. We've all experienced this. We experienced the truth that God loves us and saved us only because of that love, not because of anything we have done, could do, or will do. Our love for each other is rooted in the truth. That's just timeless and boundless grace and mercy and peace that we've all received by God through faith in Christ. Right? And that love from God is so much more than some emotion or feeling. Right, the love that God gives us is an action. It's a choice that God made to care for you and have good inclination towards you eternally. Right? To permeate your whole existence so you can express it to others. You see what I'm saying here? The love we have for the truth is what creates the love between us. God loves us first. That makes it possible for us to love him. And because of that, we can love others. That's what John is explaining here. It all starts with God and the truth that he displayed, summed up in John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Because God didn't send his son to the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Right? That's why Jesus said in John 14:16, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That's the truth. Jesus is the way to the life with God. When someone has that truth in their heart and in their mind, it's so beautiful and pure, they have a natural inclination to love it and to love others. We just can't help it. When we see something that pure and that beautiful, we just have to love it. Right? The birth of a child, a wedding day, a baptism, 68 GTO. Can't help it. But how can we do that? How can we love the truth of the God every day? Right, following Christ without some huge dramatic event to drive it. Right, how can we stay focused on it on average days when we trudge off to work and nothing spectacular seems to happen? Right, well, these first three verses say that we do it by embracing it. That's verses 1 and 2. It abides in us. And enjoying it. Verse 3, we live in the grace, mercy, and peace of God. You embrace God's truth by taking what God shows you in your scripture reading that you do every day, your devotionals that you look at on our Facebook page in the morning at 6:30, right? The sermon that you receive on Sunday, the Bible study that you attend, you rely upon the Word of God as your standard of truth. And that's embracing the truth. That's owning it. That's making it your own. And this is where you start to experience the freedom that comes with the truth. Hey, what do you do when somebody says to you, what are your views on marriage?
Say, well, I don't have a view. I have the truth of God. It was created by God to be enjoyed by one man and one woman for their life. Say, what are your views on abortion? Well, I don't have a view. I have the truth of God, that he creates us in his image, and he knows us when we're created in our mother's womb, that life is sacred, it belongs to him. And what are your views on caring for the poor? Well, I don't have a view. I have the truth of God. He wants the Christians and the churches to care for society's most vulnerable so that they can see the truth of the gospel in us. You don't have to have a view. I mean, I can share some if you want, but you've heard a few, you know, crossbows and electric cars, and I mean, they're no good. That's how we enjoy the truth. Because it lines up our will with God's will, and that's the sweet spot. That's ultimately enjoyable, and that's the joy that we get to experience together, isn't it? I don't need to explain this to you guys. Just look around. I can see 100 examples of it right here. Right? Coming to church here is like, should be like going to your grandmother's house for dinner on a Sunday. It's family. That's the love we have for each other. Some of us have it bubbling out of us at all times. Joan. Some of us not so much. You gotta dig through that New England crust a little bit for it to kind of squirt out. That's all right. It's there. That's how loving the truth leads to John's next point. Right? Christians follow Jesus by living the truth. You know, John's heard of their obedience, right? Children walking in the truth. Remember, this is a kind of a disguised letter here. He's talking about the obedience of church members in society, right? Maybe they're doing missionary work. Maybe they're sending an offering to another church. Maybe they're suffering for Christ. Maybe because of the context of this letter and the verses we're going to get into in a minute, maybe it's because they had suffered due to some false teaching that infiltrated the church. So loving the truth is awesome, but it can't end there. It has to come into our lives. It has to come alive in our lives. And he wants them to know that loving the truth must lead to living it. The truth of God's love. It's nothing new. He alludes to that. John had what he's talking about there is he had brought them, the church, Jesus' new commandment, right? In John 13, 34 through 35, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You are also to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples. The truth of God's love for us is going to infuse our lives with so much love that it will propel us into a life of loving each other. One interesting thing I hope you noticed in these verses here, because it's something you really, when you read the Bible, it's something you really got to watch out for. The word command is mentioned 4 times in 3 verses. I mean, even see a word come up twice or maybe 3 times in a short period of time should make you sit up straight. But 4 times in 3 verses, this is serious business. A life that lives the truth of God is a life of loving others. It's not optional. It's a natural Christian response that a mature Christian will have to the love that God has shown us, right? That we love one another. And then the scripture here shows us 2 main ways that we do that. Verse 4 says that we need to be concerned with what we believe, and verses 5 and 6 says that we have to be concerned with what we do. Right? Is the truth that you embrace and enjoy, is that the reason that you do what you do? Is it all based on love? Right? You don't have to wonder if what you're doing is right if your standard is the truth of God. It's all in here, guys. It's all rooted in the Bible and the gospel. It's not just behavior. It's much more than that. Right? Anybody can really behave themselves. You know that with kids. You can bribe them, right? But as soon as you run out of candy, you get a bunch of little cherubs again. The truth of God needs to be the reason that we do what we do. The truth that Jesus died on the cross deliberately so that we can be free from the captivity of sin, so that we can be free from the penalty of our sins. That's a truth that should evoke such humility and thankfulness in our hearts that we desire to obey God with all our heart and live in the truth. If you struggled, example, if you struggled with alcohol addiction for years and years, and that behavior that goes along with that addiction hurt people all around you in ways that you will never be able to fully comprehend, but your faith in Christ brought you broken and humble before God by the power of the Holy Spirit and God's sovereign will, you were delivered from that mess. Why don't you pick up that next drink that seems to call you all the time? You can name a lot of reasons, right? Your life is finally in order. The promises that you alcohol, so you can be free from the eternal penalty of all the carnage that you caused by doing that. It's the power of the truth of the gospel at work in your life. And that's just one example. Freedom from adultery or pornography or gossip or anything that beckons you can be freed. You can be freed from the gospel, with the truth of the gospel. A life free from what haunts you is available when you live the truth of the gospel. The truth that a price of infinite value was paid for your freedom from the clutches of whatever it is that wants you back. And that freedom is always under attack, because the truth is always under attack. Right? That's John's next point. Christians follow Jesus by looking for the truth. Right, these next verses, John wants people to understand why staying focused on the truth is so important. It's not just for our own information, not just for our own understanding or spiritual growth, or so that we can teach others. It's important to know the truth so you can look for it in the teachers and the teachings that come to you for your discernment. John's very concerned about the influence of false teachers in the church. And if you break down the epistles in the New Testament, they're just letters to churches. They're helpful letters from God to churches. And the amount of time devoted to false teachers in the epistles is a pretty big chunk. That's how important that is. Deceivers, they're called here. Not just people that believe false things, not people that are immature in their faith, but people who try to influence the church with false teachings. He gives them a label, Antichrist. The people who have left the fellowship of the church and deny the truth of Jesus Christ as the Messiah, as the Savior of people who repent and believe. A quick look at this text, as we read it before, seems to indicate it's a denial of Christ's future return. But you break it down in the original language, in the Greek, it's evident that the denial includes the entire truth of Jesus, his deity, his humanity, his perfect life, his atoning death on the cross, his resurrection, and his ascension to the right hand of the God. It's the whole ball of wax. It's denying the gospel, and that's what the Antichrist does. The Antichrist can deny it by subtracting from it. Well, Jesus was really just a good teacher. We don't have to believe that he was truly God. It's Antichrist says that. Right? In verse 9, he goes on to say you can also deny it by adding to it. Right? You need Jesus and good works to be saved. That's what it means when he says those that go on ahead. In verse 9, they're adding stuff to it. It's just as destructive. That's why he says here that you can't receive them into your home. Don't even greet them. Or you yourself will be part of their evil work. Remember the context of this letter, right? It's disguised as a letter between people, right? John is telling these churches, don't let them into your church. Don't let people who deny the essential elements of the gospel, the truth of God, don't let them teach anything. He's not saying don't let them into worship. He's not saying don't talk to them. He's not saying throw them out. He's not saying don't explain where their error is or pray with them. See, don't give them a format to present these views in the church. It's a false gospel. It's a great week to be talking about truth, isn't it? My goodness. Glad I got a bunch of Bibles. As it's hard to find it anyplace else, isn't it? I mean, what, you know, I mean, the world's all wrapped up in a pandemic. Where are you going to get truth on that subject? Don't look at me. I'm just like you guys. I'm doing my best to filter this information. It's not good. Or the election. Any truth there? Good luck. I get these phone calls, right? Probably just me. You pick up, you answer the phone, even though you know you shouldn't because you don't recognize the number. And the person says, "This is an urgent call from," and I'm, you know, and what do? You click. You know, I mean, there's no truth anywhere, it seems like. I mean, if you're not a Christian, that must be awful frustrating. Be like there's none. So how can we stay on top of this? How can we look for the truth? John gives us four different ways we can do it. And the first one is to recognize deceptions. Right? You have to become familiar with the non-negotiable essential elements of the truth of God. Right? The divinity of Jesus, the humanity of Jesus, his virgin birth, sinless life, atoning death, physical resurrection, ascension to the right hand of the Father. All of that Jesus Christ did. Right? Salvation by faith alone. The authority of Scripture, the sovereignty of God, the sin nature of man. If you subtract any of these from your view of the truth, the entire truth of the gospel is going to collapse. They're essential parts of the gospel. If you know these truths, deceptions are going to stand out like huge warning flags. Right? I mentioned a couple of them before. Jesus is just a good teacher that we can learn from. Right? Or the Bible's just written by men. We really can't rely on it. Or we just really need to be good. God will honor that. Or if you pray hard enough, God will bring you the wealth and the health and all your desires. Right? These are all deceptions from the Antichrist. And they're as close as your TV set. But if you know the truth of the gospel, they're going to stand out like a sore thumb. The second way he mentions that we can guard ourselves is to resist the destructive, right? Stay clear of the people and the organizations that try to push this false truth on the church. You know, a few months ago, I shared with you some information from a Barna poll, and it rattled me, and it changed the way I preach. Is that the 48% of people who say they are evangelical Christians say that they can be saved by good works. It's amazing to me when I read that. For three reasons, a lot of reasons, but you know, obviously they don't have a good grip on what an evangelical Christian is. They don't have a good grip on what the truth of God or the gospel is. And third, they must go to church somewhere. And what are they learning there? Look what Paul wrote to Timothy about how to be an elder in a church. Find it in here somewhere. I hope. I did not put a bookmark in there, but maybe I have it in my footnotes here. No, here it is. Paul established a church in Ephesus, spent a long time there, and he left Timothy there to be the elder and to appoint other elders and to make sure there was no false teachers there. And he told them in 2 Timothy, and this is the last chapter of the last book, and he was probably going to be put to death pretty soon. So this is a huge statement for him on how to run the church. He says, "I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge of the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure anything on how we're supposed to guard ourselves." This is where he talks about adding to the truth of the gospel. Right? Like the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ wasn't enough. There's something we can do to help it along, right? Good grief, how prideful is that? Like somehow it's going to get better if we do something for it. Right? A special prayer, a special knowledge, a special song, or a special person. Are there antichrists at work in the world right now that preach a Jesus and gospel? You don't need Jesus and anything. I think that you need something else besides Jesus to gain entrance into the God's kingdom is to be destitute of the truth. Right? We need to straighten that out. And then finally in verse 10 and 11 it says, reject the dangerous. Okay, and our churches and our homes and our minds need to be guarded vigilantly against all these things. You can't give them an opportunity to get their foot in the door. I'm not talking about being rude or being arrogant. I'm just guarding the essential truths of our faith against the lies of false teachers. Right? False teachers and teaching has no place in a church that's focused on the truth of the gospel. We can't let them in. Tolerance is a very pretty word. And it's a very good word. But it's also a very good disguise for dangerous teaching that we need to reject. Right? Live your best life. Best life is to come. It's not now. God wants you to be rich. No. God wants you to be obedient. Unhitch yourself from the Old Testament we've been hearing. How about learning the Old Testament? Wouldn't that be better? You've got to be careful of these false teachings. They're all around us trying to get in. The final principle that John establishes here in 2 John is that Christians follow Jesus by longing for the truth. John closes this letter with the promise to remain in the truth, and he looks forward to expressing it in person with that group of believers. He's telling them that the truth that they share has created a hope for the future. Right? He wants them to experience it together. Looking forward to the joy that God provides to people who share the truth. He has so much more that he wants to say to them, but he wants to wait and express it in person, meet with them in person. And he's so excited about it, right? He can't wait to do it. He longs for it. And he sees it playing out in our lives by, in verse 12, experiencing the fullness of joy, and in verse 13, experiencing the fellowship of family. Right? Does the truth of the gospel motivate you for the next day? Can you not wait to see what God has in store for you tomorrow? Some of you I know vibrate in anticipation for what God's going to do. We should do that. We should go to bed every night excited about how the gospel is going to work in us, through us, and around us for the glory of God on the following day. Brings me great joy. And a little bit of nervousness. You never know what it's going to look like. Right? I told you I shared some stories with you guys about picking up hitchhikers and sharing the gospel. I had a couple buttes last week. I almost ended up in the hospital. And then, I'll save that for another sermon. But I'm telling you, you get on board with this principle and it is not boring. I'm telling you. You never know what it's going to look like. It might be messy. It's going to be uncomfortable sometimes. Sometimes it's going to be confusing. But when the truth of God can flow through me and impact the world, it brings me great joy, and it will for you as well. Right? As a church, we can experience this together. That's why we hosted the Napolese church here last winter. That's how we pray for one solid month for a church that we know and support near us. Right? This month, we're praying for the River of Grace Church in Concord. The truth of the gospel should be connecting churches together. Right? We're all working in the same direction. We all love the same truth. When we see an organization, a church, or a business that loves, lives, looks, and longs for the truth of the gospel, that's our family. Right? There's some real trouble spots in this world today that we need to be praying for. Belarus hasn't been on the map, but Google Belarus. They're going through some real trouble right now. And there's Christians there that need our help. Hong Kong, China, North Korea, Portland. I'm serious. These Christians are our family and they need our help. They need our help to stay firmly planted in the truth. The truth that God loves people, right? That he created them and he's extended the invitation for all people to live in this truth, right? It's not something that we learn about and accept and then go on our merry way. Yeah, done that, did that, move on to something else. The truth of the gospel transforms us into a child of God. We accept that truth as a standard to live and believe for all time. That's why we were celebrating the Lord's Supper here today. We need to be fixed on the truth so we can long for it. We're celebrating the truth of the gospel when we celebrate the Lord's Supper here. So it remains at the center of our life and our faith. So as the worship team joins me here in concluding our time together, I think we should spend some time this week, right, examining our lives for how we deal with the truth. As a Christian, we've had the truth revealed to us. How are we handling it? Does it affect every aspect of our life? Is it pulsing through our veins? Is it in our every thought? Is it the essence of our personality? Is the gospel of Jesus Christ the everlasting substance that we rely upon to show us what actually is? Because that's what God has revealed to us. And he's right, you know. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time together. I thank you that we can somehow fathom the love that you have for us in a microscopic way. But just that tiny piece of your love can just explode in our hearts and show itself in our life, in how we act towards each other and how we have love for those that don't know you. Help us honor you, Lord, by honoring the truth that you've revealed to us. Keep us guided towards your will. Keep us separated from the spirit of the Antichrist. And help us to understand your plan for us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.